Morning, church. If you want to turn your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 13, we will be there in just a second. Hebrews chapter 13. I don't hear the flips anymore. I just do-do-do-do-do-do. Yeah, that kind of thing on your phone. I know we've talked about it multiple times and everything, and we've talked about it over and over, and you can't help but hear about it out in the world and stuff. But man, these last year and a half, whatever, has been a pretty crazy time. It's I was listening to my I'm a big 80s alternative fan, so I was listening to some Tears for Fears. Only like three people in the audience probably know who they are, but anyway, I was listening to some Tears for Fears, and there's a song called Mad World, and I was sitting back going, man, we do live in a mad world. It seems like we're living in a world gone mad, don't we? I don't know about you, maybe I'm the only one. I feel like things are going crazy. It's so interesting to me especially with this COVID stuff. I remember being in Amarillo, and I was looking at my phone, and I was reading some articles, and then I was watching the news, and it was talking about how, it was kind of talking bad about COVID, and this is just it's all hyped up and everything. But then every afternoon, I was walking into the COVID ICU unit to visit my mom, who was basically in a coma because of this horrible disease. And it's just the contrast. There's so much information that's being shared. There's so many things, and it's mad because we don't know what to believe, do we? I don't know about you, but I'm confused. Should I wear a mask? Don't I wear a mask? Do I do this? Do I get the vaccine? Do I not get the vaccine? All these other things. I mean, and it starts to make you crazy, and then you get angry, and then you start getting angry at other people, and it just causes all of this tension. Have you felt it? I mean, you feel it, right? I'm not the only one. Like, you feel this tension that's in the air. You feel like you don't want to say something because it may offend somebody else, but what's happening is the evil one has done a great job of sowing disunity, distrust, and discord in our world. And it's not just in our world. It's seeped into the church. Because there are battle lines that are drawn even with us. We all have different thoughts about it. And we're all like fighting against these other thoughts and these other voices, and this is true, no, this is true, and everything is looked at through eyes of like a political power grab. Well, you know, that's just you being liberal, or that's just you being conservative, and oh my goodness, and it's infiltrated the church. And I'm not just talking about our church, I'm talking about church Big C. Big C church. You see it, I mean, these battle lines are drawn. I mean, trust is at an all-time low. To quote the great preacher John Stott, he said this in 1982, and I think it's so true today, but he said this in 1982. He said, seldom, if ever, in its long history, has the world witnessed such a self-conscious revolt against authority. And that was in 1982. I was three. I don't know what was going on back then. But I know that I could say, man, today I just see this self-conscious just revolt that's going on in our world against authority. Anybody who props themselves up as an authority on anything is completely knocked down. We don't trust anybody. I wish I could say that we as Christians were exempt from this revolt, but we're not. Honestly, we can be just as anti-authoritarian and postmodern as everyone else. Do you want me to prove it? All right, let's do this little exercise. Let's baby step with me. Okay, stick with me. All right, we're doing good. Close your eyes, all right? So, when you're closing your eyes, what comes to mind when you hear the words authority and submission? Authority and submission. Are those pleasant words to your ears? Do you go, oh, authority and submission? Or do you feel resistant? Do you feel like you're putting up your guard and you're saying, no, 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 yes, yes, I'll be under their authority as long as I'll submit to them, but they need to make sure too. And so we have some qualifications when it comes to that a lot of times. We push against this whole idea of authority and submission. And what this has caused us to do is we question anyone that's in authority or considered an expert in their field. This has caused us to claim that there is no truth or to interpret truth as we see fit. And when this happens, and God knew this because you see this in Scripture, when this happens, all of society starts to break down. And we've seen this systematic breakdown of society. Why? Because it's a systematic breakdown of authority. If we can just get you to question those that are in charge or those that are leading or those that are leading, we turn their eyes and make it look like they're idiots all the time and stuff like that. What Satan can do is chop down this whole structure of authority, this hierarchical structure that he's put into place. And before you know it, this is what happens. Children no longer submit to their parents. Mutual submission in marriage is just thrown out the window. In serving roles like doctors and ministers and teachers, more and more they're being criticized instead of respected. But then what happens in society is it starts to do this. The Bible, and you see this happening simultaneously in our world, is as the breakdown of authority is happening, this is what's happening with Scripture. The Bible is looked at simply as a book of suggestions and not authoritative. Do you hear that conversation going on in our world? Notice it's happened simultaneously with the breakdown of authority. And eventually, ultimately, God himself is maligned and discarded as an authority. And I know this to be true because eventually what will happen is we who are worshiping God, the God that we have built up in our mind starts to never disagree with us. And we only go to churches where everyone agrees with us and says what we want to hear. And if somebody stands up and says something from the Word of God or claims to speak on behalf of the Word of God and we don't agree with it, well, then we run somewhere else because we all want to hear the same things that we want to hear. And what happens is when your God agrees with you 100% of the time, you are not worshiping God, but you are worshiping yourself and using God as a shield for that. Does that make sense? It's dangerous ground when your God agrees with everything that you are doing in your life. God is sovereign, we are not. So, how should we as Christians respond in this mad world? Man, now I want to go listen to the song again. How should we respond during this time? And I mean, I could take you to many different verses and take you through the context and stuff because this is not just one verse in here, but I just had to pick one, so I picked this one. And it's going to be counterintuitive to what you think. We serve an upside-down kingdom. And our natural responses sometimes are not the response that we need. It's not the Christ-like response. Here's what it says. And I don't have to remind you what society they were in. But Hebrews 13, verses 17 and 18, it says, "Have confidence in your leaders and submit to their authority, because they keep watch over you as those who must give an account. Do this so that their work will be a joy, not a burden, for that would be no benefit to you. Pray for us. We are sure that we have a clear conscience and desire to live honorably in every way." All right, what this passage asks us to think is it says, basically, am I inclined to follow or am I inclined to rebel? Do I lean towards trust and submission or do I lean towards distrust and defiance? I want to tell you this, being a leader in today's world, being a leader, period, has never been easy, but in today's world, I believe it's harder than ever. I hear reports constantly of seminaries shutting down. Why? Because no one wants to go into the ministry anymore. Why? Because when you sign up to serve and to wash feet and to help people and stuff, you become a punching bag. Teachers are quitting at an alarming rate. Why? Because when they sign up to serve, instead of serving, they get treated like a glorified babysitter and get yelled at when it's not really their fault with some of the things that are going on in the kid's life, you know? Police are incredibly discouraged in quitting. I've heard from different police officers and stuff, and why are they quitting? Well, because because when they sign up to serve, but they're undercut on every side. Seems like everybody's against them. You know, these places, these jobs that it used to be like, oh, you're a teacher. Well, God bless you. Or oh, you're a police officer. Thank you so much for your service. Or oh, you're a minister. Well, here, have a Diet Coke and some gummy bears. but you know, like, see what I'm doing here. All these different jobs that are serving jobs have now become there's all this distrust. We look at everyone in places of authority maybe as like they have an agenda. Like they're trying to weasel in their agenda and trick us. You know, why do we actually have a shortage of doctors and nurses because they're quitting and retiring right now? Why? Well, because they sign up to serve and people trust Google more than they trust them. Can you imagine? Can you imagine sitting there going, well, I think you got this after all the tests that we've run and all this other stuff? Well, WebMD says, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? And then when things go bad, this is what they do. They say to doctors, and this is what happens with all serving industries. This is what happens with all serving industries, but I'll just use doctors as an example. What happens is they'll say, no, I don't believe you. I don't believe you on that. I don't believe you on that. I don't believe you on that. Then they go and get sick, and who do they run to? That same doctor, help me. Wait a second, did you believe me for the first time? You know, it's interesting how we are as a people. The reason I'm bringing this up is not to get sympathy. I don't want sympathy. I know what I signed up for, and I know what other people signed up for, teachers and doctors and policemen and stuff. We know what the thing is. We signed up to serve, and that's what we're going to do. But the church has an important role to play in this time of great confusion. We as a church should be a beacon of truth and a light on a hill. This is a great moment for the church to stand up for truth and to show what submission truly looks like. I'm afraid that freedom and democracy has come to mean my ignorance is as good as your knowledge, and this has to stop. We have to be people who stand up for truth. We need to be purveyors and promoters of truth. We have to give a platform for people to speak truth into our society. And what I see happening is we are the ones that are giving all the misinformation. When I see and I track everything down of some of the information going on, it's coming from Christians. And do you know what that's doing? That is killing our witness in the world. No one wants to listen to us anymore. Everyone just thinks that we're, you know, just crackpots or whatever. They think that we're crazy. What I'm saying, and I'm not saying don't have an opinion about these things. I'm not saying don't research, but what I'm saying is we must be people of truth. We must be people of truth, and we need to stand up for that. So with that said, this morning I have the privilege to introduce Dr. Ali DeLucchi and Dr. Jared Kennedy, two of our resident medical professionals in the church, and we've asked them to come up and just talk about the COVID-19 pandemic and maybe even how we as a church can respond and help those that are on the front lines of the ministry. So let's give them a big round of applause. So I got a chance to talk to these guys last Sunday and kind of hear their perspective and what it's like to be on the front lines, what it's like to be in the hospitals day after day, and we as a whole leadership team and an eldership and everything, we're just like, the church has to know this. The church has to know this. My jaw was dropped the whole time listening to some of these stories and everything. So I just simply want to ask, you know, what are you seeing on the front lines of this pandemic in the hospitals? I mean, through your eyes, what do you guys see?
So I work in the emergency departments, and the things that I'm seeing are frustration and defeat. We've got a whole lot of people that are being admitted and not having places to go for those admissions because the hospitals have been full for nearly the last month now. I know people like to follow the updates on the ICU bed availability in the local region, and from our side, we kind of chuckle on our side because the number really is almost zero at all times, and then when one comes available, there's several people waiting in line to get it. It's not uncommon at our site to have a 3 to 6 hour wait to even get in to be seen. And then after being admitted, you may stay 24, 36, 46 hours in the emergency department to get to a hospital bed if they can get one available, which is doesn't sound that bad until you remember that the emergency department isn't built like a hospital bedroom. It doesn't really have a bathroom or a shower. It might have a TV. And so just like you're saying, we're seeing a lot of defeat on the healthcare side, where we're seeing nurses quit, nurses leave, colleagues taking time off from medicine, retiring, quitting, changing jobs, and getting out of the hospital setting. That's what I'm seeing and experiencing.
Yeah. What are you seeing, Allie?
So similarly, I work at Scott and White and Temple, so I work at a tertiary care center, and I'm one of the directors of labor and delivery. And we're having problems that we have never had before. We are having to turn away transfers. We are the hospital in the area that takes everything. If you have a problem and your hospital can't handle it, you'll get transferred to us and we will figure out how to take care of it. And in the last few weeks, we've had to turn away so many transfers. Specifically for my specialty, we've had to turn away moms that are very early in pregnancy, that are very sick and intubated, and they're stuck in an ER somewhere. That ER doctor will call all across the state of Texas, trying to find a bed for that patient. And we're having to transfer people out of state. I've heard of transfers as far as Michigan to try to find a hospital bed for someone. These are problems that we're not used to facing in our world. We are used to having plentiful resources. We're used to being able to expand and grow. And at this point, our resources are just spent. We don't have people, we don't have beds, we don't have ventilators, cardiac monitors, and we're even running out of oxygen, of all things. And it's easy to say this is just a COVID problem. The problem is that it's not just a COVID problem. Our beds are full of COVID people, but there are lots of other things going on too. And if you have a heart attack or have a car crash or you need a transplant, we're having a really hard time finding a place in the hospital to put you and people to take care of you. Yeah. So it's not just about COVID. It's about us being able to take care of all the normal things we take care of.
Right. Well, I know that you mentioned before, and I'm going to just use this term, is just this kind of whiplash of you guys are in the hospitals daily seeing all of this, and then you come back to regular life, and you've expressed this before, like, you've been like, it's just, there's such a contrast in what you see in the hospitals and what you see just out, people walking around and stuff. Could you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, actually, I mentioned that to Paul last week because we've spent so much time on the inside of the hospital and encountering all of this defeatism, and then we leave, we turn on college football, and stadiums are completely full, and it's such a contrast of we have overwhelmed hospital systems that can't provide care to people, and almost a complete ignoring of the situation. I don't know if that's the right word, and I get it, because I'm tired of dealing with it, and I would rather move on with life as usual and get back to everything as normal. And if I could turn this thing into an irritating common cold, then I would do it in a heartbeat.
Yeah, it kind of sounds like, I know that when me and my family are at the beach and stuff, and the my two older boys are digging a big hole, there's always that third one dumping sand back in and stuff, and that's kind of what it sounds like, is you guys are digging and digging and digging while everyone else is throwing sand back in the hole, and you're like, I can't, come on, guys, help me out a little bit here. That's kind of what it sounds like.
But, absolutely. Have
you experienced that whiplash as well?
Absolutely, yeah. Yes. And just like Jared said, I think we move from fighting the battle literally on one front. We're in the hospitals, we're really trying hard to keep people alive and get people out of the hospital. And then we come into a social setting and we feel like all I see is COVID. All I see is, oh no, what if you have a heart attack and we can't get you in? What if you are having a stroke and you're stuck in the waiting room in the emergency room and we can't get you evaluated because we don't have room? I think that's what that looks like to me, mm-hmm. Not relief that things are getting back to normal, because frankly, they're just not.
Yeah.
It really, everything looks like danger to me.
Okay. All right. Well, and now what is some of the misinformation that's out there that we need to be on the lookout for, and what do we do? Because we are bombarded with all kinds of this is right, no, they're wrong. Even CDC, well, they're wrong. And like, I mean, we hear all of this stuff, and it's very confusing for me as somebody who's not a professional in this, because they say all the big words and say all the big terms, and I go, okay, that makes sense, you know, or whatever. But I'm just really confused, and I don't know. So maybe you can help us with maybe some misinformation that's out there, and also just, How do we get to the truth? Where is there truth out there? How do we find that?
How long do you have?
Yeah, this could be a whole series,
right?
Couldn't it?
Yeah. I think my biggest thing to say was that this isn't over. You know, we had a big surge back in the winter, and then things started to look better in the spring, and we really kind of were seeing the end of the initial variant, and I think everybody, including us, was really excited for the relief and to go out and not wear masks and to not worry so much. And I think we all got in our heads that, okay, it's over, it's done. But then July came. And now we're in a bigger mess than we were in the winter, with fewer people in the hospital, fewer staff, fewer relief staff. And so I think the biggest misinformation is that this is over or that this isn't affecting our community.
Mm. Okay.
Some of the things, I keep looking over here to one of my colleagues who works in the ER. One of the things that he and I joke about often is there's so much information on things you should take and medications you should take. And really, we have one, and it's been studied very well, and it works very well. And it is an ounce of prevention that can prevent pounds and pounds and pounds of suffering. And it's the vaccine that's been studied that works. It's safe. If anybody wants to talk to me about it now, later, at any point, I'll be happy to do that. But that's the only drug that we've actually got that really, really affects this thing.
Yeah.
As far as finding good sources, man, I think it's hard because I see the same things you see. You know, and Facebook is flooded with all of the expert opinions about what to do, whether it's true, whether it's not true, how bad is it really? And I think that really, if you're not looking to peer review sources, if you're not getting your information directly from our medical journals, or you're not getting your information directly from CDC, then you should be getting your information from your doctor. Your buddy next door that's not a medical professional probably doesn't actually know what's happening in the hospitals around you. And so I would say that just to be very careful about where your information's coming from and to take all that other stuff with a grain of salt.
Now what, man, this wasn't on the list either, but I'm just curious, because I'm just things that I've heard. What would you say if that stuff, those people have an agenda. Those people, that's big pharma. There's political agenda and all those different write-ups and stuff like that. I mean, what would you say to that? How would you respond to that?
I'm still waiting for my checks from Big Pharma. I haven't gotten them yet.
Still waiting for your checks, huh?
I check daily. Still not there. So the initial studies that get published for most of the medications that are starting to be authorized to be used are inherently published by the pharmaceutical companies that make them. And so there is some bias inherent in that. And so what some of this confusion will come because the initial production will come out and say, we decreased mortality by 6%. That's awesome. And then as it pans out over an extended amount of use, instead of tens of thousands of people to hundreds of thousands of people, well, now the data looks like it might not be much different than giving you water. And that's when we can say, oh, well, it might not have been as great as we thought.
Right. But what you're telling me, though, with this vaccine is it went through all the trials, and I mean, it was definitely studied and researched. Just because we got it quick doesn't mean it wasn't well researched and all that other stuff, because it comes from other past information and stuff. I mean, that's what I'm hearing from you guys.
This is one of my favorite topics.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. So, yeah, so you're like, how much time do we have here?
Let me talk about this.
Yeah. Okay. Go for it.
So I'm happy, like Jared, to talk about vaccine with anybody. I don't want to really turn this into a vaccine talk, but it's really near and dear to my heart as somebody who takes care of the most vulnerable population. So emergency use authorization, which, by the way, is something that is no longer true for all of the vaccines, but emergency use authorization is just basically, instead of doing a step-by-step-by-step-by-step procedure, they were able to produce the vaccine at the same time that they were doing testing, so that when the phase three trials with the tens of thousands of people were completed, the vaccine was ready to roll out. And frankly, that was a huge financial gamble for our government and for the drug companies. Because if those studies with tens of thousands of people had come out with many side effects or with any bad outcomes or poor prevention of disease, basically all that just would have been thrown away.
Yeah.
And so essentially, the emergency use authorization, it didn't skip any steps. It did concurrent steps so that we could have this life-saving vaccine in a very short amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
The reason that it took a little longer to get full FDA authorization is because the FDA then said, but for full authorization, we are not going to skip any steps. We are going to go through and we are going to examine every facility that makes the drug. We are going to go through every single page of every single study, which turns out to be tens of thousands of pages of data. And so that's why it took a little bit of time to go from emergency use to full authorization with right. FDA.
Okay. All right. No, that's good information. Yeah, thanks. So thinking about the Christian response to this, you know, I've heard this of people say, you know, we need to have faith over fear and stuff. And actually I ascribe to that. I mean, I'm one of those people that's like, no, God will take care of us, and God is a good God, and he will protect us and everything like that. But what would you say to, I mean, and these are good-hearted people, there's not like a snide comments or anything like that. It's really people who are like, no, I'm choosing to have faith over fear, and I'm going to live my life. What would you say in the midst of this pandemic to them?
A very wise teacher once said that fear is the path to the dark side.
Yes.
And I think you're right. I mean, the moral of the underlying theme of the majority of the Bible is do not be afraid, right? You don't have to fear death. That's kind of the point of the whole thing. That being said, I don't fear COVID. I don't fear getting hit by a train. I also don't park my car on the railroad tracks in between the crossing signs.
Okay, yeah.
So, you know, I don't fear my car getting broken into, but I lock my car.
Yeah.
Okay. These analogies help any?
No, I'm picking up what you're putting down. Yeah, all right. Yeah, that's good. What would you say to that?
I think Jared summed it up pretty well, but I would also say that some of this is not about fear of COVID. Some of this is about looking around and recognizing that we have a duty to protect each other.
Yeah.
And especially right now, we have a duty to protect our children. You know, we are seeing so many more kids in the hospital this go around. Our children's hospital was at 21% of his admissions were COVID cases. And last year in the former peak, the highest we ever got was 5%.
Wow.
So just by the sheer increased transmission rates with this Delta variant, we're seeing so many more kids in the hospital. And frankly, our kids can't be protected vaccinated or not, we can carry around this virus. And sometimes it just looks like allergies, and so that's hard this time of year too, just to go out and about and assume we're all okay. But our children, who I think we would probably all agree are a sacred resource and something that we all have a duty to protect, our children can't be protected from this with a vaccine yet.
Yeah.
And so I do think that as Jesus followers, that we have a duty to protect one another. I'm not afraid of COVID. I'm not afraid of getting COVID. I'm honestly not even afraid of dying with COVID, but I also feel very, very strongly that I still have to protect my children.
Yeah. I know that we send our kids to school with masks and everything, and I was one of those people at the beginning that thought, what's this little cloth going to do to protect, you know, us and everything? But I know that the kid right next to where my son sits, he got COVID. And the rest, there was several people in the class that got COVID. I think, I don't know if it was transferred from him or how all that happened, but my son sat right next to him, wore his mask every day. We got him tested last week, didn't have COVID and stuff. So he's taking the precautions. He was washing his hands. He was wearing the mask and stuff. So some of those things really do work. they really do stop the transmission. I know you're like, yeah.
There's a myth right there, right?
Yeah.
Masks don't prevent COVID.
Speechless. First time Jared's ever been speechless in his whole life, right there.
It's true.
Have you heard that?
I have heard that.
And what would you say?
That working in an emergency department for 9 months straight, wearing a mask and taking care of COVID patients, I did not get COVID-19. Hanging out with my dad one afternoon without a mask right before I got my vaccine, I got COVID-19 right before Christmas.
Okay. Yeah, that kind of sums it up. Yeah. No further questions, Your Honor. I don't know really what's okay.
And now I can't smell coffee or tacos like we talked about.
Yeah.
It's sad. It is sad.
True tragedies.
Oh, yeah. He actually said, this is important to a person who loves himself some food. He says, now after he got COVID, tacos taste horrible to him because of the sense of smell. I didn't realize we were dealing with this kind of disease. This is, people listen. Tacos are at stake here. This is ridiculous. But all right. Well, so last question. We all know someone working in the medical field. Like, raise your hand if you are in the medical field. Got any people in the medical field here? Married to people in the medical field? Yeah, we got a few. How many of you know people in the medical field? All right. So we got a lot of people and stuff. So basically, we all know someone that's working in the medical field and dealing with this on a regular basis. What can we do as Christians to bless them, to encourage them during this difficult time? What are some things that we can do personally in our lives, but also what are some things that we can do to be a blessing to them as well?
If anybody does know the big pharma contact for the checks, that would be good. We could, yeah, big, write that down. Yeah, thank you.
Big pharma, got it. Yeah.
We could always use support. We can always use prayers. One of the things Allie and I had talked about is if there's an organization or a group of folks that can get together and send a lunch to a department at a hospital, it's surprising how fast Chick-fil-A food will disappear on shift. A lot of times we don't get a whole lot of breaks to eat in my part of the world. And right after we talked about that, 20 Chick-fil-A sandwiches and 20 Monster energy drinks showed up, and they were gone in like 7 minutes.
Oh, yeah, Jesus chicken. And that's, I mean, the chicken's already prayed for, so you're eating.
We were good. Yeah.
It's good stuff.
Pretty blessed.
Love it. Yeah, that's great. Okay, so Chick-fil-A, Monster energy drinks, prayer, words of encouragement. Yeah, what about you?
When you're around a large group of people, wear your mask and don't end up in the ER.
Okay. So one of the ways that we can help you out is to not get sick. Please, during this time, as we're trying to work with COVID patients, and this goes beyond just COVID stuff, right? I mean, this means like take your insulin if you're a diabetic or you know.
Wear a helmet.
Wear a helmet.
Don't end up in the ER with broken things.
Okay. Yeah. Make that happen, James. All right, yeah. Wear a helmet or whatever. Make sure that, yeah, no broken things. Okay, yeah. What else? Is there anything else that maybe if you thought about, I mean, we have a large group here of people. We could put our heads together and do something big. What could we do as a church maybe on a larger scale? I know that wasn't on the list, so I'm kind of taking you guys off guard. But yeah, I mean, what are some of the ideas there?
I'm not sure how tangibly to do it, but acknowledgement that there are people that are working day in, day out, without breaks, more shifts than they have any business working, to try to take care of the people around us.
Yeah.
You know, and so whether it's reaching out with a thank you to the local hospital or whatever it is, I think maybe one of the most disturbing things to me is the number of people that I think will be, the number of healthcare professionals that'll be a casualty of this time. People who won't come back, people who are so good at their jobs, but are so discouraged that they can't keep going.
Yeah.
They've decided to leave medicine altogether or to move into a consulting role where they're not taking care of patients. Because we feel defeated.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Jared, got anything?
Try and remember that, especially those of us on the inpatient side of the facility, are encountering death at a rate that is not normal. Within the last couple of weeks, the ages of those that I was there at the end of their life was 36, 37, 43, and 63, and 57.
Whoa. Okay, back up there. That was a lot of numbers. I'm not a number guy. You said those that have that died
in the last 2 weeks that I've been there.
In the last 2 weeks. What were the ages?
36, 37, 63, 57, and 46.
Wow.
Can I just point out, too, that Jared remembers the age, and I guarantee you the name and the face of every single one of those, and that he will carry that with him forever.
Yeah. Wow.
And we are seeing, too, you know, along those lines, we're seeing pregnant moms that are getting so sick. We have never, ever, ever had 6 to 7 pregnant patients in the ICU at one time in our facility. And now that is a regular part of our day. And those moms and babies, they're not faring well.
Right.
You know, and so again, this is about protecting those really vulnerable people. And this is not just about being in the hospital and then getting out. You know, but people are dying. We're delivering babies that are going to be in the NICU for months and months, and they'll probably have problems for their entire life because they had to be delivered early.
Yeah, because you said when a mom gets incubated, you have to take the baby immediately, right?
Depends, but most of those moms, if they're sick enough to get intubated, then their babies are not, they cannot oxygenate themselves and their babies appropriately.
Yeah.
And so most of those babies were delivering because of distress.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, I think I speak for the whole church, and I do hope that you express your appreciation to them. They're actually going to be at the information desk back here. If you have any questions for them or anything, please come talk to them. They'll answer any questions that you have about that. But one, I want you to know, just thank you so much for what you do on behalf of this congregation. And one of the ways that I think at the very least what we can do to show our solidarity with you, to show that we are for you. And I'm going to ask the congregation to do this. And we'll just say, we'll start off, we'll baby step for the month of September. Let's do this, okay? For the next few times that we meet, just out of solidarity, regardless of what you think about mask, no mask, vaccine, no vaccine, all that other stuff. What I'm going to ask is just out of solidarity for the medical workers that we have in our body, in our family, I really want to encourage you to wear your mask. Let's wear a mask and stuff because I think what that will do is when they walk through the doors, they'll see us mask up, and maybe if it's not for any other reason except just to say we love you, I think that's enough right now. Okay, so I want to encourage you guys during the next few weeks to wear your mask, not only here, but when you're out and about and everything, and really find this week, find a way to bless and to encourage our medical workers that are still getting beat up by this horrible pandemic. But thank you, Jared and Allie, for being here and for just sharing truth with us. And that's what we need to do, is we need to hear truth. So if anybody has any questions or whatever, please see them at the information desk, or if you need their contact information or whatever, I can give you an email address or something so that they can respond in their own time to that. But I'm going to ask one of our shepherds, Stephen Kilpatrick, if he would come up and say a prayer for those in the medical field and just for this pandemic.
Join me in prayer, please. Gracious Father, thank you for being our God and being our Father. And it's at times like this that as a people, we feel the stress of life. We feel the pressures of the things that are going on around us. And Father, we know that we don't have the answers. And this last 18 months or so has been proof that we in many ways are inadequate to handle the difficult things in life. And Father, as we have been informed and enlightened about what it's like to be a frontline worker, we hear that phrase in the news and read it in the paper and see it in many different forms, but what does that really mean? Well, it means Allie, Jared, and others that are part of our congregation and other church families that are there every day doing what they do, understanding how fragile life is and how precious it is. Help us, Father, to have wisdom, discernment, and courage in the decisions that we make, the way we conduct our lives. And help us, Father, not to be selfish in our thoughts and in our desires, but to truly do as your Son exampled to us, to serve, giving up of ourselves to serve others. And that may in many ways be inconvenient. It may be a difficult thing for us to do, but help us, Father, to have the love that is concerned more about others than ourselves. Father, we pray for your healing hand to be on those that are so affected by all of this. And it has hit many of us closely and homes that are struggling with it. But Father, we pray for those that are in the medical field and those that are right there every day trying to stay on top of this. Give them courage, give them strength. May they know that they are appreciated. And may we do everything that we can do to protect them, to protect our children, and to protect each other. Father, just help us to love in the measure that you've loved us. And that love was expressed through Christ. And it's through his name I pray. Amen.